Helen Hardin, daughter of well-known painter Pablita Velarde, was born in 1943. In her all-too-short life, she reached a level of success and fame few painters achieve. Initially, Helen painted in the same style as her mother, but by the late 1960s, her work took on its own look and became instantly recognizable all over the world. In the early 1970s, Helen was part of a very small vanguard that changed Indian art from traditional to modern contemporary. Helen was the lone female in this group of six iconic artists. By the early 1980s, she was truly in a league of her own. In 1984, Helen died of breast cancer, but her work lives on in museums and private collections from coast to coast. This show of over 30 works includes many paintings not seen publicly since they were painted. Helen Hardin, A Straight Line Curved, is at the Pablita Velarde Museum of Indian Women in the Arts, Santa Fe, New Mexico, from June 1st to September 30th. Admission is $10.
Hello. My name is Margaret Bagshaw, and I would like to welcome you to the Pablita Velarde Museum of Indian Women in the Arts. This museum is named after my grandmother, Pablita Velarde, and was established to celebrate and showcase the work of Native women throughout North America. This is a permanent display of my grandmother's actual working studio. On her painting table, you will see the last casein painting she was working on. Her eyeglasses, her brushes, her last pack of Salems. She always had the TV on to keep her company. This is her Mono and Matadi, where she hand ground her earth pigments from rock, clay, and dirt. All of the colors she used came from the earth. After grinding, she would mix the powder with white glue and water and use this mixture as a paint. For the next 25 minutes, I would like to walk with you through the museum and in particular to tell you about our new show, Helen Hardin, A Straight Line Curved. This show is the most comprehensive show of my mother's work and includes 33 treasures from the first known Helen Hardin original painting to her last finished painting and the last unfinished painting that she was working on at the time of her death in June of 1984. This show is displayed chronologically so you can walk through the paintings as they were done. We did this to give you a better idea or perspective of the development of Helen Hardin's painting style. This next clip is from an interview my mother gave in the 1970s that offers some insight into her thoughts on her place in the art world.
I'm not the American housewife, but on the other hand, I'm not the woman's liber either. I can't get into movements, whether they're women's movements or Indian movements. I'm just not programmed for that. I'm very independent. My work reflects my independence. I've never had formal training, and I am very proud of the fact because I have succeeded in the art world, and I don't really have to credit myself to any school or any teacher. I don't imitate any artist, and I'm just completely my own person.
Okay, let's take a look at this amazing show. This first group of paintings are all done in casein watercolor. Casein is a milk fat-based watercolor and is one of the two mediums that my grandmother, Pablita Velarde, painted with during her entire career. Mom started in casein and gradually switched to acrylics starting in 1969. The first painting, Mother and Child, was painted in 1957 when my mother was 14. This is a painting that I often saw at my grandmother's home. Originally, I thought this was a painting of my mother holding a newborn me, with my cousins looking on. During the writing of my grandmother's biography, the author Shelby Tisdale came upon some family correspondence that referenced my grandmother as having had a miscarriage. At this point, I changed my thinking and thought that the painting was likely inspired by that event and showed grandma with the baby that wasn't. As we were reframing this painting for this show, we had a chance to see the back of the painting and, much to our surprise, saw, in grandma's handwriting, that the painting had a title, Mother and Child, and was painted when mom was 14 in 1957. This is currently the oldest known Helen Hardin painting. Next, we see a painting that would fool most people, powwow. I bet your first guess would be that this is one of Grandma's paintings. Well, it's not. Mom started out painting just like her mother, Pablita Velarde. Powwow was likely painted when Mom was about 16 in 1959. The painting with the shy little girl standing between the two Kasharis has an interesting story. In 1960, Mom was awarded a Rockefeller Fellowship in Arizona. Apparently, when the program was finished, Mom needed money to get home. Upon calling Grandma and explaining that she had no money for a bus ticket, Grandma's response was, "You know how to make money. Paint something and sell it." This is that painting. The story has been retold for a long time, and the untitled painting has become known as The Way Home. The fourth painting is known as Hungry Bugs. This was likely painted while Mom visited Grandpa in Virginia in 1960, shortly after the Rockefeller Fellowship Program in Arizona. It was at this program that Joe Herrera taught Mom the splatter technique that would soon become one of Helen's ever-present hallmarks for the rest of her career. It is interesting that the only influence that my mother ever acknowledged was Joe Herrera. Joe was Tony DePena's son. Tony DePena was my grandmother's acknowledged mentor. Joe Herrera likely learned the splatter technique from Raymond Johnson. Raymond Johnson studied Wesley Kandinsky. While Mom was pregnant with me, Grandma felt it would be safer if she hid Mom from my real father. The Navajo reservation was as safe a place as any to hide Mom and an unborn me. While Mom was there, she painted Navajo men and Navajo women. Notice there is an abstract element creeping into the background of these two paintings. We can now see Mom starting to develop a style that is moving away from Grandma's. In 1968, Mom took me to Bogota, Colombia to get away from my father. We stayed with Mom's father, Grandpa. He worked for the U.S. State Department and arranged for Mom to have a solo show at the U.S. Embassy. It was a smash hit and Mom sold almost everything she had painted. White Buffalo Dance was one of the Bogota paintings. Painted in 1968, this was almost the end of Mom painting in casein watercolor. Notice the beginning of a definite cubist style in the figures. Now we move into the acrylic paintings. First were the regular acrylics up until 1976. After that, everything was painted in iridescent acrylics. In 1971, Mom took me to visit Grandpa in Guatemala. He had been transferred there, and his boss had heard about the success of Mom's embassy show in Bogota. He asked Grandpa if Mom would be interested in doing a similar show in Guatemala. She was thrilled at the idea. We arrived in Guatemala City in early spring of 1971, and Mom began painting for her new show. I remember the beautiful parades in the street during the spring celebrations of Easter. Courtship of the Yellow Corn Maiden came out of that show. If you look closely, you will realize that this is very similar to the Bogota painting. The reason we hung these two buffalo paintings together is because they show a development of style over a 2.5 year period. This is almost the same painting, but look at the development. Look at the development of the cubist style in the second painting from the first. Look at the background of the second painting compared to the first. Look at the development of a bolder color palette. Also, look how her signature changed. Next, we see an early example of Mom's acrylic work. Kashari Eating Watermelon was painted about 1970 and was somewhat of a step back to what she called her cute little Indian paintings. Over her career, Mom often would revisit the Kashari watermelon imagery. We have seen a few of this style. We now move into a very significant period in Mom's body of work. Here we see some of what has become known as the petroglyph paintings. During 1970 and 71, Mom and her friend Susan would go and hang out at the ruin sites, often Galisteo. Here, Mom would pay particular attention to the rock drawings and soon began to connect with the ancient world. This group of paintings mark Mom's connection to that other world. It is believed that there are roughly 12 to 15 of these petroglyph paintings. The first one is surrounded with pot shards that Mom found on these visits to the ruins, and possibly some she made on her own. The second petroglyph piece is called Ancient Rock Art of My Ancestors. This is more complex than most in this series and features very dimensional figures. The five colorful figures in Yeas show Helen's precise, exact geometric style. Painted about 1974, it has a strong native feel to it, but an almost graphic vibe too. Note the colors of the 1970s. Next is one of Mom's most significant and most important paintings of all, Prayers of a Blue Corn Mother. It was painted in 1974 and marked my mother's transition all the way into the other world. This painting has all of the elements of Mom's best paintings over the next 10 years. Background masks, blending of background and foreground, precise abstract designs, and amazing detail work. She would stay with these elements and this look in all of her major pieces until the end of her life in 1984. Santa Clara Black on Black features the Avanu, or water serpent. Striking in shiny, dull black with red accent color scheme, the main imagery is borrowed from the familiar Pueblo pottery motifs. Interesting, though, is a center image, the stylized mask that would soon be a part of many of Helen Hardin's paintings and etchings. Merging of mystical men and masks, painted in 1975 and shown at Mom's first show at Fenn Galleries. This painting is very typical of her style during the mid-1970s, before she moved into the iridescent acrylics. Note the masks overlapping one to the other and interacting with each other, the crazy line work in the evergreen boughs and the patterns of the background. Next is Bears Crossing Canyon. My mother had a great affinity for the bears, and she recognized them as the traditional healing symbol of Pueblo lore. This painting is typical of the medium-sized acrylic of the period, and while it appears relatively simple and to the point, take a closer look. There are a lot of geometrics in the background, and the colors are getting bolder. This piece shows a change of direction and is still obviously a Helen Hardin painting of the mid-1970s. Notice the shiny finish. Mom was always working on her finishes, whether they were slick like this or mixed in with other material to give a raw look. Universal Protector was painted in 1975 for the same Fenn show as Merging Mystical Men and Masks. The color palette is obviously the same. Notice the extreme detail in the bird, in the feathers, and the body. Perhaps what is most interesting, though, is the background. Look closely and see the small mask figures, very reminiscent of Prayers of a Blue Corn Mother. Is the Universal Protector the front image of messengers in the background? Masks After Picasso was painted in 1976. This is a unique painting for Helen in that there is an unusual exaggerated vertical ratio, something she did not do often. This is almost totem-like and features vertical overlapping masks, mouths turned into eyes turned into mouths. While there is not a lot of plumage, we see what would become typical Helen Hardin turquoise collar necklace, almost in a corn-like pattern. Overall, quite cubist still. Look at the very detailed, subtle background. From 1976 is Merging of the Evergreen Chorus. This is another typical mask style painting with plumage and overlapping masks and faces. Eyes turning into eyes, turning into eyes. Everything on the faces joined and continues into the next one. Again, we see the almost corn-like turquoise necklaces, but this time on each face. Also note the prominent but controlled splattered background. Within Myself, I Am Many Parts was painted in 1976, and this was the genesis of the idea of Helen's famous etching, Changing Woman. In this painting, we see the face looking outward and at the same time looking in profile. The profile allows for a split face on one side looking outward and the other side looking inward. We see the different native hairstyles, both Pueblo and Hopi, when looking straight on, and Navajo when viewed from the profile. This depicts universality. The four seasonal colors depict change. We see the very prominent splatter technique that was part of almost everything she painted after the Arizona Fellowship in 1960. This was painted just before my mother's transition into iridescent acrylics. Also from 1976, we see Winter Moon. This is a very striking single face Helen Hardin mask. It is very strong, geometric, and bold. The line work is very obvious in forming the face of the moon. Notice the circles radiating out from the center of this painting, and once again, a somewhat split face. Ceremonial Song and Masks from 1979. This is an interesting painting with an interesting backstory. Look at the background. It is very minimalist, but with her splatter technique, the masks are moved forward. Look at the jewelry and plumage. It has changed to something very simple. The masks are still overlapping and the color is getting bolder. Here's the backstory. My mother traded this painting with Charles Lolima for her wedding ring. The wedding ring is in the case with her jewelry collection. The ring has an offset diamond and an extensive design work on the inside in typical Lolima fashion. Old Age Brings Visions of Rainbows is from 1980. This is a somewhat typical Helen image of a single person sitting with a robe on, somewhat reminiscent of her chief's robes piece from earlier. However, look at the extreme cubism in the blanket. The face is somewhat realistic and almost self-portrait-like. Notice the moon formed by simple circles. Again, very big, bold, bright colors, but used with warm and cool iridescence. Autumn Processional was also painted in 1980, while Helen did a number of heartline deer paintings, and this is very reminiscent of her later etching, Deerslayer's Dream. There is much more layering of the animals than usual. This was likely one of her final overlapping deer paintings. The interesting fact behind this painting is that Nordstrom's department store used the image for the promotion of their autumn product line that year. Messengers of Winter from 1981 has a very recognizable Helen Hardin background, but look at the very subtle snowflake pattern behind the three kachinas. The snowflakes designate these as winter kachinas or messengers. The headdresses are extremely cubist and almost graphical in the design. The faces are very strong kachina imagery, almost realistic, except they are my mother's own imagined kachinas, not anything from the native culture. This realism is perhaps what frightened the tribes. These images represented something they had never seen before, but that appeared as real and powerful as anything they had imagined. Notice the collars around the necks, very strong and imposing. Overall, a strong, bold, colorful painting. Here is the interesting behind-the-scenes story on this painting. Do you see the small happy face designs on the Pablita in close to the head of the bottom left figure? Mom decided they looked a lot, kitschy and painted over them. This was likely Mom's way of having the last word with the owner of the gallery. Change the painting to what she wanted after the poster was printed. Mimbres Mama was painted in 1982 and shows how my mother could get maximum impact with only two colors. While this is a somewhat typical Mimbres design of mother and child, it is interesting that the bare breast is painted at the same time as Mom had her mastectomy from her breast cancer. Mom also painted a second version of this piece, although the second image is reversed left to right from this one. Once again, we see the connection Helen had with the Mimbrus imagery. Almost everything in this painting is based on very old Mimbrus designs. The base of the mother and child, the perimeter, circle, the four corner points. My mother was very clearly the Mimbrus mama. Visions of Sunset is from 1982. Once again, we see a very subtle background that is very full of geometric design elements. A single Kachina figure, this was obviously the design for Listening Woman, the third in Helen's Changing Woman series. Notice how the main body image is filled with sections of detail, and yet the painting, as a whole, has a very sparse feel. This is in fact a very simple painting for the time period, in spite of all the detail. It almost appears as if the foreground image is semi-translucent against the background. Again, too, we see the turquoise corn-like neck collar. This untitled painting is a large, full-face, straightforward mask painting from 1982. We can see a lot of strong detail with obvious but minimal layering. Somewhat of a darker color palette makes this a very strong image. Overall, this is a simple face shown in a very complex manner. Harmony Brings Gifts from the Gods is probably one of Helen's greatest paintings ever. The brilliant, strong color mask imagery appears as a wall of spiritual strength. Perhaps one of my mother's largest paintings, this has absolutely flawless symmetry and composition. Mask over mask over mask over mask, and yet it never feels repetitive. This painting signals a turning point in color for Helen. She has started using bolder, more vibrant colors with an increase in color values or intensity. At this point in 1982, my mother had had breast cancer for about 6 months. She is starting to paint what she wants, how she wants it to look, almost without regard for the critics or gallery owners. Incantations of the Four Winds, painted in 1983, was my mother's reconnection with the spirits of the sky and the spirits of the universe. This was her talking through the winds, hearing the songs, hearing the rain, hearing the four directions. This painting is soft and gentle, but deep and strong. Present are the elements of Helen's cubism, Helen's mask imagery, Helen's patterns, her zigzags that struck like electricity. The bold colors appear covered with a mist. Guardians of the Night is from the last year of Helen's life. These guardians of the night stood to protect. Again, strong, solid geometrics create unmistakable spirit mask images in very bold, solid, saturated colors. Notice the ever-present plumage and how the rest of the painting is almost entirely completely geometric. Even the jewelry is cubist zigzags. Can you see three overlapping faces? Guardians of the Sun was Helen's last completed painting. Originally painted for the Nabisco Corporate Headquarters show in New Jersey, this piece represented the Guardians at the opposite end of the spectrum from the previous painting, Guardians of the Night. Everything that Helen became known for, whether it was the patterns, the iridescent paint, her crazy dots, her zigzags, the geometrics, her spirit faces, her unbelievable layering technique, her saturation, her own spirituality, and the message, it's all present in this painting. Her final presentation of all of it. Last Dance of the Mimbrus is the painting that my mother was working on at the end. The obvious question when looking at this painting is, where is this figure going? Or where is it coming from? This Mimbrus style image, as ancient as it would be on a pot, or as modern as it would be on Helen Hardin's table, is the last painting my mother would ever touch. Unfinished, notice the tail at about 1 o'clock in the inside of the tail circle. The red outline stops. She could paint no more. She was tired, and she said, "I'll finish it later." Considering the heavy medication that she was on, look at the incredible line work, symmetry and foreground, background composition, the attention to detail. Perhaps as extraordinary as anything she ever painted. She stopped painting this painting 9 days before she died. It was the last dance of the members' confirmation that Helen felt she was the last members.
I put my entire self into it. I can just, nobody, I don't think any other artist around for miles would put the energy into 4 square inches of space as I do in a day.
Also, in this show, you will see a collection of previously unseen pen and ink drawings that were done in the last 4 years of my mother's life. Her doodles say a lot.
Three important women, three important artists, three important stories. Historically, they represent the only documented three-generational full-time professional female painting dynasty. One opened the door, one changed things forever, and one took native art to the mainstream art world. Pablita Velarde, in her own words, by Dr. Shelby Tisdale, director of the Museum of Indian Arts and Culture. Helen Hardin, A Straight Line Curved, by prominent New Mexico writer Kate Nelson. And Margaret Bagshaw's memoirs, Teaching My Spirit to Fly. For more information or to order your books, please call 505-988-2024 or visit us on the web at www.thethreebooks.com.